Hallozeen is created in Nam, lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. We pay our respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging. Sovereignty was never ceded, always was, and always will be, Aboriginal land.
Yourself?
Hello, I'm Michelle Harford. I'm an artist, zine or comic maker, sculptor and pyrographer.
What kinds of zines do you usually make?
I bounce between sort of self-reflective or philosophical kind of artisines and comedic comic strips.
Can you show us some of your favorite Halloweenish zines?
I really enjoyed the Black Bookshop's Jason, Momo at Choose Your Own Adventure, dating zine from a few years back.
Have you made a Hallozeen for this year? What is it about?
Sort of. I made a folk horror poem thing called Alone in the Dark, about five travelers getting stuck in a forest as the sun goes down. I also have finished volume 3 of Sammy Doom, The Dancing Demon, but that's more comedy than horror.
What was your favorite part of making it? Did you challenge yourself to do something unfamiliar?
With Alone in the Dark, I'm trying harder to push myself visually, in both detail and visual narrative. With Sammy Doom, I'm trying more for consistency and learning how to write. I'm more of an illustrator than a writer, so keeping track with a continuous story is a challenge.
I find that zines are a nice medium for telling stories that start as a troubling concept or fascination that you tell people a few times until the story develops its own rhythm and beats. So once it's articulated as a small booklet, It's captured and finite. My question is, do you have a weird story that you've struggled to express, but were compelled to keep telling it to make it make sense? How would you make a zine out of it? Have you done this?
I find I do this a lot with more philosophical or self-analytical zines. Sometimes they become standalone pieces. Other times, they will inform the beginnings of other projects. Writing anything about dreams always has a very vivid, intense snowball effect that I generally cannot keep up with, which has resulted in many projects being started but not completed. Alone in the Dark started out as a full 9 verse about being stuck alone at home and hallucinating about things that may or may not be there, and evolved into something else entirely.
Halloween is a bit weird in Australia and has a free-form meaning to a lot of people. What's your favorite vibe about Halloween?
I like that it normally holds back the tide of Christmas decorations, but I'm growing to love the dress-up and decoration aspects. It reminds me of a macabre masquerade ball, which I'm here for. Jack-o'-lanterns are rather cute.
Recording in progress. Hello!
I am Helen. I make zines about animals and mental health and spooky goth stuff and sexy zines sometimes and and big deep thoughts and just processing stuff and insecurities, but also very silly goofy stuff.
Yeah.
And I've tried to go for a horror one for this Hello zine. So it's not coming in this cute bag, but here's the very sneaky reveal for the 2021 Dewey Mon Helen zine of for Hello Zine. Brennan's review. And it's just like a take on like doing an Instagram outfit of the day thing, but the whole idea is it just gets more and more just like spooky. It's also full of references. So I'm not going to spoil them all too hard for you, because I want you to see them. If you like horror movies.
Yeah.
If you like horror movies, you'll find plenty too in there of like references to horror movies, and you'll be like, yeah. And also some silly movies.
What have you got for show and tell?
I got a lot. I've pretty much just like unearthed all of my Hello zines that I've collected.
I love it.
Over the years. So I've got a lot of show and tell. So my favorite Hello zines are all of them. It's hard because I just collect them and they're all such sweet little babies. So I'll just do a quick whoa, that's just black. Just a quick look at some zines. I actually really like this one because the illustrations are pretty. I just like spooky illustrations quite a lot.
Oh.
Like an Inktober style, everyday different challenge sort of thing. And I think there are a few of them. I think it's just like very coincidental because Hallozine culminates with Inktober, like Inktober's end. So there's just like a lot of like good spooky content that arrives that's also inky, and
I love Inktober. Oh, nice. Who's this by?
This one is by Jess W.
Yay!
It's just like super nice, really detailed little like some spooky, I guess some also cute, but like just like eerie for like drawings, which is all I want.
Yeah,
like because there is like a tiny bit of a narrative going through, which is quite nice, and I really enjoy when people get like a narrative going in a zine-y. This is the Emily Never Festival. This is where we celebrate Emily Never, our number one, also our bi icon.
Oh, yep.
Queen. But my favorite one of hers was this one because it was just like such a fun event that we did. So it was like
Hello Zingles.
Yes, it was the before times. Also, like when you look at her handwriting, you're like, she just writes like she's Disney.
Yeah, it's the Disney handwriting.
It's the Disney writing. Gosh dang. But then I was looking at it. I'm like, oh, I have a crush on you already. Adorable. Like, look at all this great dating tips.
Mm-hmm.
Like, look at all these great things about you. Love it. I love, it's just so good. It's just like talking yourself up. And also just lacing Halloween together with a singles event.
Yeah.
This one was like a pleasant surprise. I believe this was a hallozeen one. Mm-hmm. But it was by like a textile artist who was just like, here's some monsters. Here's what they do. And it was just like, this is really sweet and cute and awesome.
Oh my goodness.
Which I think like has the vibe of hallozeen.
I love so it.
So cute.
Who's this one?
This one is Mega Felt.
Mega Felt.
Which Sarah, I believe her name is Sarah, but Mega Felt on Instagram at Mega Felt. But it's just very cute.
Oh my goodness.
And also just this is a very big mood.
Yeah.
Because like when I look at these zines, it just reminds me of like being together and like having Hello Zine with them again. And like that everyone's like, I made a zine. It's just my usual zine, but a Hello Zine edition.
Yeah, I love that.
And I think that's just like, oh, that's great. It's just like eking it into it. So it's like, it technically counts because I put Hello Zine on it and I printed it in orange.
Yeah.
Pumpkin feelings, which goes along with like just pumpkins. Not that it's like season appropriate for us now, because pumpkins are very from Liz, which is another like Inktober sort of one. And I enjoy the black paper with the black text.
Black paper with black text.
Yes. That's power move.
Power move.
Like how goth can you get? And like he just has such good like automatic style drawings. And I really enjoy them always. And they're always so like eerie and spoopy, just the line work and how it's treated. Oh, like I just feel like a lot of her drawings walk straight out of what is that show? Twin Peaks. I just feel like a lot of her drawings are very Twin Peaks-esque.
Yeah.
I don't know why. See, I think it's all the checkers.
Hmm.
All the checkers.
He's so cute.
Oh, baby. and this one's just very good because I love like a silent narrative. Like,
yeah.
It's just Tom Nguyen did it. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to remember what their Instagram is, but
either Bakatom or
Bakatom. Tom Doodles. Yeah. Tom Doodles. Yeah, Tom Doodles. And it's so perfect and wholesome. It's just a good vampire. Mm-hmm. Don't eat the kitty. Oh, a tiny one from Little Mira. It's just like a vampire dating and like how they dated through the ages. So it's just like, oh, so cute. Like a lot of different like period dress and everything in there. Oh, I love it. Our dear lovely Beck, who is so very helpful.
Oh, yeah.
Putting together. I've got a bunch of her hallozeens.
This is a trilogy.
It'd be maybe cool if it was a trilogy. I just realized that these both have moons on the back. I wonder if I wonder if they're actually supposed to be like a, you know, sequential.
That'd be fun.
Yeah, like just they're just cute little like ideas for cursing and haunting people and things. Cassie did this great one that's like about these New Zealand teenagers who killed themselves. Oh, no, wait. I think they either killed their parents or something, but it was just I like it when it's like a bit true crimey.
Yeah.
Just like a nice little true crime nugget. Delicious. This one is very good. It is by our good friend Nara. it's just someone peeling away the layers, just peeling everything off. Show what we all have inside. And it just resonates really deeply with me. A skeleton. Like, it's so uniting. We should all look to our skeletons to bring us together.
Yep.
A tiny history of the jack-o'-lantern is very, very good.
Mm-hmm.
Very on brand because I came as a pumpkin to this interview. It's by Dr. Jesse Eggy. And it's a nice little concertina. Ooh, you can get the full history. You can learn everything you need to know about lovely pumpkins. I got this cute one that is like werewolves dating by our dear sweet beau. Oh, it's just lesbian werewolves.
Yeah.
And butts. Yes. That's all I'm going to show. It's lewd. But it's so cute. And just a lesbian werewolf romp. Beau Parsons.
Yep.
But with X's. Our dear little Han has done a zine or two as well that I have.
Mm-hmm.
And it's I know this one blows my mind because I'm like, how did you get a different color paper in there?
Oh yeah,
it's just an 8-page folding zine, but it's no longer. It's like a different. That's insane. Yeah, it's just a nice little like. Another like illustration based one. I think I always end up going for the illustration based ones because I like drawings. I love it when people do them too.
Hard relate.
Yes. Just like lots of really cute little sweet Halloweeny drawings.
Hey.
This tiny baby. I like this because it's quite good to take to like workshops. And you can just be like, because this was just originally an ad, right?
Or
which one? 2019. Oh, memories.
Memories.
A tiny one that's by Avery Flinders. It's called Springtime in Halloween Town, which is very like Nightmare Before Christmas, seems like. But like, it's just a very, it's like a nice, oh, there's an actual sticker in there.
Oh.
Ooh. And then there's a recipe in the middle.
Ah, nice.
But that's good because it's like a nice little like Halloween zine that's like actually like paying attention to Australia and the fact that we're in springtime right now.
Yeah.
And it's not really autumn. So all the autumnal stuff is like, you know, when you get your zines just start like migrating into other places because you like get them out and you look at them and you show them to someone and then you put them away, you think.
Yeah,
you think you put it away. Oh, I haven't even seen the Jennifer's Body bit. Oh my gosh, I only recently watched Jennifer's Body because I hadn't seen it before, and now I'm like, dang, that was such a good romp.
Yeah.
Oh, queer icon Babadook. Again, these are good like inspirations if you need like inspiration to watch something, some like horror for this season. Definitely turn to Emily Never. She will hook you up.
Nice.
Oh my gosh. Ah, she's got Ginger Snaps in here. Oh my gosh. I've been watching Ginger Snaps with Liz. We've been having platonic life partner like dates. So
yeah.
Come over and we'll watch some Ginger Snaps.
Nice.
We're just working our way through the sequels and the prequels and things. Oh my gosh. Just watch a lot of spooky movies. It's time. Oh, I need to watch the witch movie. Oh, speaking of, but like the witches movie. This one I just watched the other day.
Oh, that goat, okay. Yeah.
That goat can get it.
Yeah.
Husband material. Satan, husband material. I want her to cover such films as Midsommar and Lighthouse and things. Yeah. Horror's been getting good again.
Yeah.
A bit of a dip there in the 2000s. Bexley bringing us the good imagery again.
Oh, Bexley.
Like Bexley Felix on Instagram, aka Beck, aka Zine Mom. it weren't focused, but like, you know, good spooky imagery with like a goth lean. Oh, love it.
Hi, how are you?
Pretty good.
Well, we should introduce ourselves officially. I'm Blue Raven. Good to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Blue Raven. I'm Alex.
You can find my website's BCH Comics, and then on there you could find links to all my social medias. I've been, you know, making zines and been in like the zine scene for the last couple years, but this is really the first year like I'm seeing Halloween zines like everywhere.
Oh, nice.
So it's like, oh, wow, I need to like really up my collection and start getting some stuff out there this time of year too.
So what have you got for show and tell today?
Oh, well, I was going through my collection and I realized I don't have as many Halloween zines as I thought I did.
That's all right.
But I've got some that really popped to mind. This one blows me away right away because of just how tiny it is.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, it's really cool. I got it as part of the Pikes Peak Zine Fest zine trade last year. And it's done by Kelsey Chu.
Oh, yeah.
And there's all this cool Halloween art inside.
Oh my goodness.
I love the ghost there. Oh, you gotta love the cat. This is another one that I love. Like, well, not necessarily a Halloween zine. It is definitely spooky. And as far as like horror projects and stuff like that go, I love it because it focuses on somebody's journey during the zombie apocalypse. You know, whereas, you know, in zombie movies, zombie comics, you usually focus on the people who are like, oh, they're hardcore. They found some weapons. They're out there taking out zombies and everything's good.
Yeah.
This is just a person who in normal life was shy, didn't, you know, really want to stand out or anything like that. But since the world has fallen, you know, they found their way to make a difference. And what they do is they go around because they're naturally sneaky from the shyness and stuff like that. They find places that are safe and they mark them safe. And if they're not safe, they mark them not safe. It was done by Victoria Benny. I Survived. That's I think this was a one shot, but it is so good. The colors are vibrant. The art is beautiful. And it just goes down her journey of like everything I said, you know, she's like didn't want to really stand out, but
you know, I love that. Like not overly military, overly combative zombie genre. Like,
well, cause again, it's something you just don't see. It's crazy. And let's see. And if not for this interview, I would not have realized that I actually don't have a copy of Coin Operated Press's Halloween zine.
Okay.
This is a copy of their zine, The Troll Flayers. So that made me realize I need to go get their copy of their Halloween zine. And they're awesome anyway. And they actually have a open call for zine submissions for their Halloween zine they're doing this year.
Oh, nice.
So, yeah, so that's one thing I plan on submitting to that too. And, you know, fingers crossed.
Was that Coin Operated Press?
Yep. Yeah, they're out of Scotland. And they do great work. I've been in a few of their zines and awesome stuff. Very well put together. And, you know, it's just varying topics. You know, there's always something interesting. What do you have any projects you're working on right now? As far as.
So this was mine where I don't know if that. Oh, yeah, that kind of turns up.
Oh, that is nice.
So I just gave myself the theme of drawing little monsters that were just, there's two of them. So
you are an incredible artist. Wow.
That's what I do. So instead of, because I think all of my projects kind of flounder as soon as I have to write anything. But if I just have to draw one picture that kind of tells a story enough, then that's fine. And so I made a couple of those.
Well, and one thing I'm looking forward to coming up, Vlasinda Stormdrain of Vlasinda Productions going to be doing a Halloween very quick here. It's supposed to be coming out like in the next couple weeks or so.
Oh, yeah.
I did a submission for that, so I'm very excited about that. I can't, obviously, since it hasn't come out yet, I can't show you like the actual pages yet, but I can show you some of like the rough inks, stuff like that.
Oh, cute. Ah, nice. Is that just felt tip? Are you using brush?
No. Yeah, it's just regular felt, you know, like those micron markers and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's nice. It's clean.
But yeah, very excited about this. And it's another installment in... So my father was a musician. I went by the name Nicodemus. And he had a recurring character in a lot of his songs called the Greenland Rider. Well, since his passing, I have since... gone through and have started like making Greenland Rider comics. So this is another installment. So, and then in the Phoenix Zine Fest is going to be going on later on this month. And they had an omnibus that we could all, you know, all those people were going to be presenting there could submit to. So I have the Headless Harley Rider, which I included as a comic on there, which is from Nick Davidson Matches album, Better Art Music. Aww,
so good. I love being able to get the characters traveling forward in time, just like keep them going.
Well, it's cool too, because I mean there's of course a lot that can be said in song, but you know even more that can be said, you know, carrying that song into a comic.
I was finding like making my Zine Fair Halloween themed, and it's Australians don't know how to process Halloween as a theme.
Okay.
It's like new. It's not entrenched in any tradition. I think until about 5 years ago, if anyone trick-or-treated your door, it was like a 1 in 20 that they'd open the door at all.
Really? So is Halloween not really celebrated there?
It's not a thing. And I think okay. I think maybe 10 years ago, people were like, no, that's American. We don't do that. And like, we've got a lot of like immigrant populations, but it's all like Italian, Greek. And it's like, okay. Yeah, it's weird, like getting people to try and like process like, okay, what's our relationship to Halloween? And
right?
Usually it's like horror movies. I've seen a horror movie. And then I think getting people who like love fairy tales and folklore to be like, oh, it's us as well. Okay, cool. Get everyone patched in. I think I love when it's people who make zines and just like telling them like you can totally just make an autobio zine about your anxieties and fears. And yeah. I love the content that comes out where it's like every day is Halloween when you've got anxiety. And it's just like lists of everything they're scared of. And it's like, so I watched Jumanji as a child and this is how it ruined me.
Oh God, the tsetse flies alone were enough to give you nightmares.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So I love that when I do this Halloween fair and it's like just people the processing things.
Yeah.
Like it's such a external concept kind of culturally.
Here, well, the least. Thing that's so cool about that is you can pretty much just make it your own at that point, you know? Which I think is really cool, especially, you know, like you're talking about with people making zines about it, you know, get a bunch of creatives and they can pretty much create their own mythologies and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm. I've also taken it upon myself. I'm going to gather a bunch of like art trades I've done and other Halloween and Inktober themed stuff that, you know, fit in that horror genre and condense it into a zine, which will be available on my website, bchcomics.com, because I have like a free section where, you know, you just download zines and comics and stuff like that that I've done. Something I've been loving is all the digital zine fairs and stuff like that, because in my area, there's not a giant zine following. Okay. I mean, it's starting to build, but, you know, it's not like... like in Chicago, there's a giant zine following. I actually joined their zine club. They have a zine club every month, like at the end of the month. And, you know, there's a theme. Nice. We all get on Zoom, you know, I'll talk about zines, show off some of our collection, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And it's great because everyone is, you know, so into it, so passionate about it, you know. Whereas, like I said, here, you know, you'll find a zinester few and far between, but it's not a big thing yet. I started out, you know, making comics and stuff like that. I had a webcomic for 9 years that I'm slowly but surely, you know, remastering or, you know, and putting into print. But if I'd waited for like an actual like printer or stuff like that, because I know I'm realistic. I know artists who are leaps and bounds better than I will ever be. and they still get rejection letters. Like, yeah, no, you know, I just want to start getting my stuff out there and then I'll tackle the rest later, you know.
Yeah.
There's a couple local conventions that always you know like make you feel like
you're a hot shot.
Like, hey, all right. The last convention I was able to go to in person was a local convention called Confusion. It's a literary convention. And I got to table next to Carmada Arts. Dear friend of mine, like a random zinester I met, you know, out in the wild.
Yeah.
Yeah, she did the color work for my most recent comic, Just Another Day, number 2.
Oh, nice.
And she's a super amazing artist and zine creator herself.
And it's like just meeting them at like conventions, like sat next to each other.
Right, exactly.
So good.
And then the weekend was just a blast, you know. We both just shot the breeze, like, oh, what are you working on? I've just really enjoyed, you know, coming out and talking.
It. Oh, have fun. Have a good evening.
You as well, and thank you again.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Hey. Oh, that's nice lighting.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I was a bit worried about it. Our backyard gets really very, like, intensely sunny after a while. So, you know, places I can pull a witch's hat anyway.
Nice. I love when it's, like, a hat from a certain angle. It counts. Oh, thank you. Thank you for joining me.
Please.
Cool. Well, did you want to introduce yourself and what kind of zines you make?
Sure. Hi, my name is Jess W, spelt D-U-B-B-L-U. I'm a illustrator. I mostly make autobio comics making fun of my partner, but I also do a lot of spooky stuff on the side whenever possible. So I like making monsters whenever
whenever I can.
Oh yeah, I think I saw on your Instagram a lot of cute little ink people.
Yeah. Well, like, you know, I'm in lockdown, so I can do Inktober for once, which is of nice. So I'm doing a bit of Witchtober to try and do a bit more character design sort of stuff. And yes, it's been very fun, but you know, I would also like to go outside, so that's nice.
Yeah. I think there is that, like, it's nice to have the peer pressure of Instagram to be like, just get out like 30 of one set and be like, wow, achievement. But also, I am doing this for fun.
I just might be able to finish it this year. I've only finished Inktober once before, and that was because the prompts were just enough that I could kind of hobble it into a story about a spider woman. I think it was like 2018 or so. So yeah, I didn't finish it by October, but just the having to finish the story was enough to like get me through it.
Yeah.
But yeah, this year I've just taking it easy and, you know, doing pictures of gin stills instead of cauldrons and things like that.
are you working on something to release for Halloween?
Yes. Well, Halloween is my birthday.
So fortunate.
So I love it a lot. So I was thinking about what I could potentially make and just the amount of times that, you know, someone who looks the way I do and dresses the way I dress and things like that, when you say your birthday is Halloween and people go, well, that makes sense.
yep. Real so chicken I'm and egg.
So, you know, when your friends come over when you're about 12 and they go into your garage and they're like, why are there tombstones? It's like, well, they're for my birthday. It's a regular experience that you should have.
I love it.
So yeah, it's just little auto bio stuff about making fun. It was just kind of a follow-up to a zine I did a few years ago about my dad accidentally threw away all our Christmas decorations, so mum made new ones out of bin bags. So I made a little how-to of that.
Oh, that sounds wonderful.
I only found out about it because like they smelt really bad. So here am I at 5 years old putting like bows on the Christmas tree being like, mum, these stink, what are these? And yeah, it wasn't until years later that I found out that it was because it was leftover goon sacks.
I mean, it might correlate with a lot of other Christmas experiences with the like rum soaked cakes and like maybe that ambient scent is Christmassy. It fits the theme.
Oh yeah, no. A sack of goon, like goon of fortune, is a very different experience.
Oh yeah, yeah. You're doing the Inktober challenge and lots of witch drawings, and mm-hmm. You've got this autobiography coming out. Is that kind of what you usually make as well, or do you make something else?
I've kind of got my hand in a bunch of different pots usually. Autobiocomics are kind of like how I unwind and just, you know, make a joke so I don't have to like be too overly serious about things and you know, tell people stories without having to repeat them again and again. And yeah, other than that, I work for a place called Science Play Kids, and we do science classes for kids between like 2 and 12. So I do a lot of illustration for them. So it's all very technical stuff. So it's nice to sort of like break free and do something very spooky or like not have to be too worried about terrifying a small child.
I've been working with kids through Girl Guides, and I love when it gets to Halloween season and then they realize you're one of the adults on board with Halloween. It's like, oh yeah, we are totally going to gear all of our activities around this.
Oh, absolutely. Like, yeah, because being a kid in like the mid-90s, just wanting more than anything to go trick-or-treating.
Yeah, it's and not a thing.
Literally slam the door in your face sometimes. And yeah. I love, our neighborhood does the whole like, well, usually in times that are not COVID, put the little jack-o'-lantern out the front to let you know that you're a friend, like, you know, a friendly spooky person. It's just really sweet.
Yeah, I'm enjoying everyone's like reactions or everyone's impressions of what Halloween is in Australia, because it's so untethered. Like, you don't have a generation above you saying, well, this is the way that it's done. Mm-hmm. It's like, it isn't. You're making it up. It's fine.
Yeah, that's what's so exciting about it. Like, now that everyone's sort of getting on board, because it used to be like my birthday party would be the event, and now I have to split it between all these people who have like grown up yeah. watching Hocus Pocus and have decided, oh, I want to do that too.
Yeah. It must be nice to be like the wizened elder of this. I've been practicing. I've been indoctrinating all of my social circles. Well, I think I also ask if you have favorite zines and if they're Halloween-y, but favorite yeah. zines nonetheless.
Well, it's not strictly a zine, but I did want to bring out this lovely little inlet picture. It's really hard to see in this lighting. So a few years ago, my mate and Sarah and I did a show, like a show at Trocadero Art Space about the program Over the Garden Wall.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so she made me this, like, really lovely little illustration, which is like cut out pieces of paper laid on top of each other to replicate the woods. You've got nice. Like the little Beatrice bird flying off into the corner and stuff like that.
Yeah. Can you give us a little yeah. a little tilt back and forth? Whoa. Oh, yeah. I love it.
She does a lot of pop-up books. And yeah, some really beautiful like watercolor illustration work. And yeah, so yeah, definitely check out her Instagram because she's got amazing things on it.
Nice.
I've got a bunch of Emily Never stuff.
Yes.
Because I started going through my zine collection. I'm actually kind of like disappointed in myself with the amount of spooky zines I have, but I do have yeah. like a decent amount of Emily Never things.
A staple.
Yes, absolutely. I actually did manage to get down to Hobart for Mona Foma in January this year, and they had a zine stall up there, so I got some fun things like that. This book, Decomposition, which is by Bailey Decay, which is just a really lovely little progress shot of some skulls, well, a head deteriorating
into
a skull. And yes, oh, and The Bog People. Which I picked up a while ago now. Yeah, it's from 2008, but it's just a short story and it's very like gothic and like very like the landscape is very visceral, which is which I really love, particularly because I picked it up because when I was a kid we had a book called The Bog People and it was folks that had gotten caught in bogs thousands of years previously and just looked like leather handbags. So it's not actually about that at all, but like I will pick up anything that says The Bog People because I found them hysterical when I was five and I just think they're really creepy and wonderful.
I think I got really into them for like a 6 month period because I found out about like the bright red hair that they had, or a lot of them had, because it was like a chemical process that preserved the hair. So it was like luscious and glossy, but also just like fiery red. And they were like figuring out whether these were all redheads who'd fallen in the bog, or that's just what happens. I loved it.
Yes, well, because underneath the pink is a natural redhead. And so, yeah, it is interesting when people will just like unsolicitedly tell you like when you've been sacrificed to different types of history. Just like, hey, cool, I'm gonna go up there now.
Yeah. Do you have any other favorite things?
Let's see, what have I got out here? Oh, Disconnecting Tales, which it's very like it's more in vain with the sort of stuff I do where it's jokes about horrific things rather than, you know, any sort of sense of reasonableness, but little jokes about wearing your heart on your sleeve and having that be a very literal sort of exchange.
I love it. People touching it with their thumb. Oh. Oh boy.
But yes, no, like love a good joke. I've also got from, let's see, Jumon from a couple of years ago there in Inktober for 2018, which is like very lovely and like tarot inspired and got some really gorgeous line work in there.
Oh yeah, I love their work. Do you have where people can buy your zines online?
Yeah, so if you go to my Instagram or my website, which is jesw.com, spelled dubblu.
Oh, that's what it is. Yes.
Yes, it's the worst decision I've ever made, but it's on everything now.
Yeah, I feel that. I guess thank you for talking. And
no worries. Cool. Thank you so much.
Have a nice afternoon.
You too.
Bye.
Bye.
What we're doing, what I've been doing all month is sword timber, where draw a sword every day for the month of September. I'm just going to show you them and I'm going to name them.
All right.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, so the prompt for this one. So I get a word every day and I draw a sword.
And right.
This one, it was shadow.
All right.
So it doesn't have to have shadow in its name, but like...
Darkness or...
Oh, yeah?
Nightblade.
Nightblade. That's good. All right. Nightblade's good. So the prompt for this one was light.
Glow sword or shine sword?
I like shine sword. What about?
Yeah.
What about sword of shine?
Yeah.
Sword of.
Shiny.
Shininess? Shine?
I like to shine. Yeah.
All right. So for this one, it's insect-like. I've drawn like a little bug for the handle.
Emerald ant.
Oh, yeah. That's good.
Or ant gem. Something. Cool. I like emerald ant.
Emerald ant is good. So I've got 15 of these.
All right, sure. All right.
This one is ghostly.
So ghost blade or ghost glow?
Ghost glow. What about sword of ghost glow, ghost and
yeah, sort of
so put ghost yeah. and glow in there. Ghost glow sword, sword of ghost glow.
Yeah.
This one was lava.
Magma blade or magma sword, or just magma.
I like magma blade.
Yeah.
We haven't got many. Blade ones. Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah.
This one is snow. So I put like icicles there. And each of the icicles is made of tiny swords.
Ha, cool. Snowy blade or snowflake?
I like snowflake.
Yeah.
Nice and simple. Snowflake. This one's a storm one. So it was storm. It's got a lightning at the end. Lightning bolt.
And then cloud. Storm star. Or...
Oh, yeah. Stormstar.
Yes, Stormstar.
Stormstar. That's good. This one's Anchor.
Anchor something. Anchor. Anchor Sword. Or.
Anchor.
Anchor Slasher. Blade.
Anchor Slash. That's good.
Yeah.
Anchor Slasher.
Anchor Slash.
Anchor Slash. One word.
Yeah.
Anchor Slash. Yeah. This one was summoned. So I was thinking like this little bit is a solid thing that you hold, but then the rest is just kind of made of light or energy or something. So it's like a thing you hold and the rest gets summoned, like kind of like a lightsaber.
Yeah. Should it be like a saber or more like a sword? I think it should be a sword, but the sword of light blaster or light blaster.
I like light blaster.
Yeah.
This one was banished. So I don't know. All I was thinking, so that's not the actual sword.
Yeah. It's
wrapped in cloth and then wrapped in chains. Some kind of banished or like a forbidden.
Forbidden blade or forbidden sword. Or just the forbidden.
The forbidden blade is good.
Yeah.
The forbidden. Yeah. Because then it's like it could be not even a sword in there. This one was dwarven.
It was stone, like a stone. Yeah.
A fat, heavy, thick thing.
Something stone or stone something. Power stone. Power stone or like. What would it be like?
I feel like it's the most. It's not magic. It's just a rock. You'd like holding a big stone. Something kind like of like
Rock fighter or rock.
Yeah.
Rock sword. Yeah, rock fighter.
Rock fighter is good. This one was elven. So something elves use. I don't know much about elves.
Like a magical elf or a Santa elf?
like a magical elf. Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's very elegant. It's very. It looks expensive.
The golden elf or the golden sword or the golden elf?
The golden elf.
Yeah, elf blade.
Elf blade? Yeah.
Yeah.
The golden elf. I like putting that as one word. Elf blade. This one was delicate.
Oh.
So made like a, it's fancy. It's kind of probably more decorative than something you'd use for fighting. I'm thinking like a one, you probably use it one time, like a one use.
Yeah.
And then it'll just break.
Omega glass, because it looks like it's made out of glass.
Yeah.
Omega glass. Yeah.
This one was aquatic.
Tides? Yeah.
Like a sword of tides?
Yeah, tide sword, tide.
Tidal?
Tide.
What do we got? We've got blades, we've got swords.
Tide Summoner.
Tide Summoner? Yeah, that's good. That's good. This is the final one.
All right.
So this one was Forest. So I made like a...
Wooden Warrior.
That's good.
Yeah.
Cool.
All right.
Can you do your best, like, YouTube thumbnail face? Like, maybe you're thinking, or thinking of names. And I was like, yeah, that's a good one. Yeah. All right. That's good.
All right.
Okay. All right.
Thanks for watching. Thanks to Elvis for naming those swords. The zine is this right here, Sword Solutions for the Lone Adventurer, the Hello Collection Volume 1. It's available at my Big Cartel. I'll put the address here. Hope everyone has a good Halloween and Hallozeen, etc. See you all soon. Thank you.
Hey, I'm B. I write a zine called All of My Mistakes, which I just write AOMM all the time. And everyone's like, what is that? So if I had a do-over, I would pick a shorter zine name.
Yeah.
Tonight, I've tried to dress up as Daria.
Oh, yeah.
Which I don't
I can see the lapels.
Yep. So today I have a copy of the Halloween zine that I made last year. And it is All of My Mistakes, Volume 20, the Spooky Edition.
Oh, nice. Is All of My Mistakes a series that you do?
Yes, it is.
Oh, yeah. AOMM. Okay.
Yeah. So there's like 27 of them.
Oh, nice. I think.
And a bunch of like special editions. So, yeah. I have been a little bit prolific. So I hate horror movies, but I love Halloween. So mm-hmm. I like dressing up and things like that. So it's the usual sort of zine. I have my introduction page, which is just like a standard page I have on every single zine. And then I just have like a blackout poem about Bridget Jones. So I took a Bridget Jones and just like made it into a horror story.
Oh, nice. And
it's a story called Bridget Jones's Day, a dazzling insight into the demise of a 30-something. So it goes for a few pages. This is quite an epic. Then I drew some spooky animals. I have like, I don't know how well that's showing up.
Oh, it's great.
Yeah. So I had a how to draw animals book. So I just did that, but made them spooky. So there's that. And a few more. Then I talked about Wednesday Addams because I love the Addams family. Oh, like that Addams family values. I used to know every single word to that entire movie.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. I think I watched it too many times. And then this one is something I thought we could do together. So,
oh, nice.
But it's a, like, insert a word story.
Yeah.
So you put in, like, all the words and then it will reveal a story.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I made this and I was like, this is such a cool idea. Then I printed it out and had to cut out
all of these
little boxes.
How many copies were in this print run?
I think I've done about 10 so far.
Okay. That's manageable. Yeah. I'd love to have a go if you want to facilitate that.
I would love to do that. The instructions is the story has two characters, name and spooky name. Pick one name for each and use it throughout. And we'll fill in the boxes with the class of word requested. So like noun, spooky noun, you know, things like that.
Oh, yeah.
So you have to pick a noun.
A noun. Jar.
Jar?
Yeah.
Okay. And a second noun?
Oil.
Oil. Okay. And a spooky noun. So that could be something like pumpkin or witch or cobweb.
Spider.
Spider. Ooh. And then a time of day?
Twilight.
And a name.
Jonathan.
Jonathan. Are we doing J O
N? Sure.
J O N. There's so many ways to spell that.
Oh yeah.
And then plural noun.
Cats.
Cats. Okay. And then we fill in Jonathan's name in a few spots.
I don't think I've.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, I've never done a Mad Libs where you actually put, you have the stencil over it. I love it.
Awesome. So I need a spooky noun from you.
A spooky noun. Yeah. Ghost.
Ghost. And a past tense verb.
Oh. Plunged.
A spooky name.
Dracula.
An adjective.
Sunny.
Yeah. And a noun.
Car.
Okay. I actually, it's been a while since I've read this, so I can't remember what this is going to turn out. I need a past tense verb.
Ran?
Yep. Pick yes or no?
Yes.
Another past tense verb?
Died.
And a present simple tense verb?
Present simple tense verb.
Which is like eat, drink, play.
Play sounds good.
Okay. All right. And we are done.
I'm so excited. So
we're revealing the story. So the jar and the oil, a tale of spider. It was a dark and stormy twilight. Jonathan was at home, surrounded by cats. Suddenly, Jonathan heard a knock at the door. It was a ghost. Jonathan plunged. The ghost said, "Hello, my name is Dracula. I am very sunny. I have come to your home for car. Will you give it to me?" Jonathan ran and after a moment replied, "Yes, Dracula died. Very well then, it is time for you to play."
Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, that's so good. I've done little workshops where we do like how to do a spooky story for kids to do, and just like another way to do this. It's so good.
Yeah. It's kind of fun. I like the interactive element. I started playing around with that for a few of my zines. Like I had a word search in one of them.
Yeah.
I love
when there's an activity.
Yeah. Anyway, I just write about spooky things. A lift in this building that I used to live in.
Oh, yeah.
When I went, it was one of those old fashioned lifts where you had to like pull open the door and then pull open the grate and then step in. And then every now and then it would stop halfway between floors and you'd be like, "I'm not going to get out."
Oh, wow. Was it like shut in, or you can see the open floors past the grill?
You could open the door and you could get out if you wanted to. You wouldn't want to.
It would just be uncomfortable and risky.
Yeah. And then I had a story about a ghost tour that I went on once.
Oh yeah.
Ages ago, yeah. I have a curse. Halloween party first. There's a Halloween party that I like to go to run in Sydney here. I went to it every single year, and every single year something terrible would happen.
Nice.
I still love going. That's why I went like six times.
Oh, that's so good for a Halloween party though.
Yeah. And then I hate scary movies, but I'll read the synopsises on Wikipedia.
Yeah.
Which is a very strange thing to do. And then I just sort of wrote about the synopsis.
I feel that feeling.
Yeah. And then that's the end of my zine.
That's so nice. I love it.
I have another zine. I was part of, what is it called, Otherworld Zine Fest last year when it was digital.
Oh yeah.
And I got a few orders, and one was kind of local, like a few suburbs away. So I was like, okay, cool. Sent it away in the mail, didn't think about it. Went down to my mailbox one day and they had like dropped me a zine.
Oh, nice.
But they hadn't even posted it. They had like come to my house and this is that zine. just about movie reviews. It's kind of cool, actually.
Yeah.
But
that's a thick one.
Yeah, it's a big one. Wow. Lots of content, lots of text.
I have dug into the vault and found a few fun ones that you may not have seen. Found ominous affirmations. Yeah, it's my favorite spooky one of hers. It's very succinct. Just
like, ooh.
Yeah, perfect. Very spooky. Love it. So in the vaults, I have found this one. I can't quite figure out who did it, but I must have bought it for a good reason. I realized that I love atmospheric themes in zines that make them spooky. Mm. So I found this one. Flies.
Oh. Oh, nice. Yes.
It says Le Gros Monsieur, but I don't know. It's from 2011. It could be anything. Big this one I really, really like. It's by Resiato. It's called Melting. And it's got a concertina of mutated creatures, which oh, wow. I really, yeah, I like this one. The illustrations are fantastic. Resatio, R-E-S-A-T-I-O.
Nice.
I got that one from the Newcastle Writers Festival, so he could be a Newcastle-based artist. I love my friend Estelle. I've tabled with her many times, and this is her comic about how shitty the dating scene is in Sydney.
Nice.
And yeah, I think a lot of her illustrations are very much revealing the anxieties of putting yourself out there. So yeah,
risky.
She's fantastic. Love her work. Her mother was also an accomplished artist, so I love seeing her carry that on. I've got La Petite Morte. We're getting a bit spookier now.
Oh.
This one's by Lee Rigozzi. It's from 2012.
Hmm.
So you've got cartoons that are starting to lean towards less atmospheric and more particular.
Yeah.
Themes of spookiness.
Yeah.
I think that naturally we're all drawn to spooky things, no matter what way they're shown.
Hmm.
But given that I don't have too many traditionally spooky zines, I always found it interesting when I ended up finding them in my collection. This one is probably my prize spooky zine. Hmm. I got it at the first zines fair that I went to in 2010. It's called Tactful Ornithology. So I think it was made by a design student. Let's see if I can remember who it was by. This is a Newcastle one. Matt Nicoli and Sam Shepherd. So we have a collection of ink works that examine like narrative themes, but it's only one story per artwork. I did think of your interest in gothic horror, actually, when I was looking through this again.
I like the having one story per page or spread, because I think every time that I do a picture, I'm just like, do I have to write a whole story to go with this? Probably not, actually. just bung them in.
It's, yeah, you don't have to commit as much, and you can still say a fair bit, as you can see. Like, how much can you fit onto one page? I mean, this is not a small zine. This is,
yeah,
this is like A5 per page. They don't have to be. they don't have to be complicated in order to be spooky.
Those teeth. They're so good.
Yeah, they're got some Stanley Donwood style Edward Lear illustrations here.
Nice. And this is the same artist?
Yes, the two of the same artists.
Okay. I love it. I love it oscillating between these two extremes.
Yeah, the contrast is excellent. So this is the crown in my collection, because it's just not afraid to get unhinged. I think with illustration, people mistakenly believe that when you have it doesn't even have to be a compilation. You can still tell a story in multiple styles. So
yeah.
So that's Tactful Ornithology, a compendium of neo-nouveau post-literary works by various pseudo-authors with accompanying illustrations by Matt Nicolai and Sam Shepard, funded by the Loft Youth Venue in Newcastle.
Oh, nice. Oh,
get this. It's way older than when I bought it, which was in 2010. This is from 2007.
Have you got your latest?
I do.
Do you want to give us a preview of that one?
Ooh. Absolutely. So this is The Peak of Most Horrifying Truth. And I wanted to touch briefly on how rough it's been for my ADHD in lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
It's been really fucking shitty. in the sense that I only just got diagnosed at the start of this year, and I thought, oh, I'm handling this kind of okay. And then I started to not handle it okay.
Yeah.
So I had to learn more about the symptoms and how to manage them. So to me, it felt like climbing a great mountain and feeling like there's this ominous sense of anxiety. So you climb the mountain and you're getting further up and you know there's something there, something terrible waiting for you. And you've got horrific anxiety about the whole project. Then you get to the top of the mountain and the monster, it was you all along. So it was your...
Oh, that's sweet.
Turns out the dragon's just chilling. You're the problem. So I needed to confront that thing within myself of having a pandemic-based executive dysfunction and calling myself out on my own bullshit really helped me get through it.
Yeah. I feel like that's going to be a recurring theme for this year.
My name is Nev. My artist pseudonym is Never Never. I suppose my most active social platform is Instagram, nevernever.art. My pronouns are he, him. I'm a comic artist primarily. I have just realized that I grabbed all these other comics but didn't grab my own. they're around here somewhere. And I did do some other things before this. I used to be part of a zine distro and collective in Borloo, so in Perth, that was called Zero with an X, Zero Boys. But we were similarly like we were. we wanted to see more of the sort of DIY and like fanzine kind of stuff, music fanzine stuff, as well as a couple of us being cartoonists. So we sort of came together to do those. And in my own, in the last couple of years, since I moved to NAM, I have done these ones. So we have Sydney Grace, this comic. That's nice, which is also part of comic sort of thing.
So nice. So
I think I've done another two since then, but because we've all been in lockdown, I've pretty much entirely done them online. I've been in this situation where it's like both not very useful to print them right now because I would people would have to pay for postage and I can deliver them just as easily this way. And where I want to step up the production level of what I'm doing, these are both office work specials, and just wanted navigate that, getting a nicer print. So since these two I've done... now I've got to remember off the top of my head. Varnish, which is about two vampires who are A and Ace having a discussion about sharing a coffin. I did, what is it called? I Think We're Alone Now, which is my Valentine's Day comic. I often do like a Valentine's comic. This one was a Valentine's comic. Sydney Grace is about him working out the courage to propose to his girlfriend. And I Think We're Alone Now is about cross-dressing and young love, I suppose. Yeah, and then I did Glad to Be Gay for Pride Month this year, and that was about sort of how some queer people don't have difficulty with Pride celebrations,
yeah.
I suppose. Yeah. And again, it's just two characters talking about it, like one of them has had a quite traumatic experience as an older gay person. And it's like, I just don't feel like celebrating. And the other one is like, try it. Fine. But yeah, those last three have all been digital at this point. But one day.
One day.
And yeah, so that's what I usually do. I am also like, I write prose and have all sorts of projects. My current project, which is for Hallozeen, I suppose.
Yeah.
It's, in concert with Hallozeen.
Yeah.
is another, it's a comic. It's in full colour this time. All my previous ones have been in either half colour or black and white. And it's about a group of punk teenagers in the late 70s. Who are going to a cemetery in Manchester where they live. and to on Halloween.
Yep.
To have a spooky night and to check out, like, a year before there was an attack on a woman there, which is a unfortunate part of history, but they sort of have an argument amongst themselves about, like, how we engage with true crime, especially when it doesn't affect us personally.
That's nice. I like that.
So I've got sort of two categories of things on here, and I've got the really Halloween-y themes and also some slightly more serious themes from Sophia Parsons Coates, who I believe is involved heavily in Halloween, and they're all wonderful.
Yep.
There's Brian's Wolves. I've got which song, which is the sun's lick, and Dire Witchcraft. I think Brun's Wolves is my favourite.
Yeah.
There's just something.
I think I'm in that one.
About it, and being very local, probably.
Yeah.
Live Brun's Wolves right here. So those are wonderful. I do enjoy those very much. I've got the difference between goths and emos, which is by a young artist. He goes by Jack. He's wonderful. I'm not sure if he's doing anything for Halloween this year because I know he's been very busy with his finals.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, just a like really great emerging talent. obviously there's a Burton influence, but also it's been really interesting seeing him pull in lots of other influences over the last year or two that I've known him. Lots of classical art, lots of Gothic literature as well. I know he was very into 10,000 Leagues Under the Sea for a while. It's really interesting seeing how his stuff is evolving. So I have here I Love Danzig, which is Emily Never.
Yep.
Who did the Halloween poster this year, I believe.
Yep.
so barely needs introducing. I actually wanted to find a copy of her Gothtober zines, but I could not find one. It is here somewhere.
I feel like I've shown people and then it's gone into their collection.
Yeah, that's definitely happened. This is not the first copy of Goths and Emos that I've got either. That one's definitely walked before. And I know this year she's been doing horror movie posters. You can just like really see her passion for what she's creating, as well as the like bold style. Just a catch. The last one that I have here is Chris Mark's Cryptid Handbook. And they are Chris Marks on Instagram. It's again like it's a beautiful character design sort of compendium. Very surreal and creepy little entity. And the other category of thing that I have here is, I mean, I like to also think about our relationship with death and things like that, the dark parts of life when we at the same time sort of mediate on it as well. So I thought I would recommend some Fantasy Sunday, which is by Jess C. It's a very freaky cyber horror scene about mental health and things. So, just the design in it is wonderful, frankly. I have Dirges, who I don't actually know who the creator of this one was, except I've got Spurzine at Gmail at the end.
Spurzine at Gmail.
It's a really beautiful little essay about delivering a eulogy at their father's funeral.
I do know who this is. With,
yes. And how ephemeral life can be. All right. Yeah. I was reading it just before and was like, oh, it's really beautiful. And the other two I have are from an American scene creator, Aiden, who goes by, and you'll have to excuse my French, Pissed Anarchist 420 on Instagram, who I know through a friend and who is lovely themselves. They're partner, who is also my friend, sent me some art for one of my birthdays. This is in a frame back there somewhere. and they sent me a manila envelope that was just full of these tiny zines. And I'm like, what is this? I didn't expect to get this. But they're wonderful. They're these little already dead zines. And each of them is just like a couple of words on a subject with a collage is the word. And these two particularly are about sort of, again, death and the how ephemeral life can be and trying to appreciate it while you're in it. Again, like that very little expression of passion that I really appreciate in the very short zine format. Yeah. So that's what I have.
I love it. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you for talking to me about
that's it. All right.
And I really look forward to what Hallozine connects us with this year.
Yeah.
And I managed to keep my teeth in the whole time.
Good job.
Hi, my name is Bo Parsons. I'm a Melbourne zinester. I like making things about werewolves and dogs, this dog specifically. You get like a crash zoom. If you're signed up to the swap, you might get a copy of my zine.
Well, happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween and happy Hallozine.
Happy Hallozine to one and all. What have you brought to show and tell?
Right. Well, I have all of these.
Nice.
And because I refuse to play favorites, because I love all of my children equally, and also I don't have that kind of attention span, I am just going to rifle through the box at random, pick something out and talk about that. So this is Body Horror's Haley Wells. It's HW Illustrator. There's poetry and fiction about sensation of horror and horror movies and kind of the bodily aspect of horror. It's very short, it's very pretty. It is mostly kind of the same. Of the
oh, yeah.
Exterior. Mm-hmm. I do really love these brush marks, though. Pretty. Oh, wow. What's this? Oh, it's Dragon Egg by Alex Clark. So this is from 2017. Well, it is still a horror comic. It's by the very talented local engineer, Alex Clark. Very beautiful, because that real hyper detailed and not quite.
Oh, that's good.
Like, crazy amount of detail that I always aspire to. If I remember right, I think this is about a dream she had.
Yes.
Do you know anything about this one?
Yeah, it was a dream I had.
This one is Ghost Music Volume 2 by David Witteveen, which is an illustrated short story collection. And I really like that a lot of David's books are not just a straight up A format. I like that they're usually like a little bit square, a bit long or something. I know it's really silly, but it's just really fun to hold bits of squares while I'm reading. It makes me feel fancy. Music inspired slash fiction. And like smash through it in a couple of minutes, and I love it. It's nice, like a little mixtape. This one is, I have multiple copies of this in varying sizes. I have at least an A4 copy.
Yeah. That's the OG Hallozeen.
Yeah. It's Tim's, yeah?
Tim Newport.
Yeah. It's pretty. So it's photo collage.
Yeah, he had the really high-res PDF of it still. So I've got that up to read on the Hallozeen launch website.
Again, I don't think this is a Hallozeen, but it's
no, it's just more, but more it's still horrifying. Horrific. Yes.
It's still like deeply unpleasant.
That's what people know about my zines. Deeply unpleasant.
Yeah. Like beautiful, but this is a repetition by Alex E. Clark. Just about getting stuck in a riptide. Ooh, horrible. But no, it is a very beautiful. Oh yeah, looks so beautiful. This is Mouse Dabbit. Ominous Wishing. It is every single ominous wish in Twin Peaks.
Oh.
By virtue of being Twin Peaks and being ominous, I figured it deserved to go on the pile. But I love that this is brims away. And it's very cute. I swear it had a poster on the inside. So cute.
So nice.
And it folds out. Folds out. Oh, I hate doing this. There we go. And then the poster in the interior is the telephone magic.
I love little magic. I read it last week. It's on my Land Dream side
lovely
table.
Oh, Tender with a Vampire. Yeah, chiller. I will go through these very quickly. And the OG.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. Yes, these are independent comics done by locals, so you can too. Oh, Cool Sticky Picks by Tiffany Ewing. Which is, oh, it is cute. It is cool and spooky.
Oh.
Scaly. Oh, so cute. It's really nicely made. The paper's like a little bit. And then, yeah, that's to skew it. I just really like that print quality. It's lovely. It's just nice. Red Right Hand, which I, again, this may have just been a festival to photocopy of, but it is about murder doggies.
Hey.
It's beautiful. I'm a big fan of murders and doggies. But Mia's art is lovely. So Murphy's Possum Productions on Instagram, and I think DogFan411 on Twitter.
DogFan411.
These games do not exist.
Oh yeah, I interviewed the author for Festival.
Yeah, yeah. It's yeah, Will Broom. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a little sinister. But I really like, I'm always a big fan of, I guess, like stuff that may as well be real but isn't.
Yeah.
Ooh. This is definitely a Hallozeen. This is from Hallozeen on the back. Oh, I know it's from Hallozeen. Literally the only reason I know it's from Hallozeen.
Yeah.
It's Helen Graham. Oh, it's so lovely though. Like it's just really very beautiful. Yeah, I just like the paper. Oh, another clear chiller.
Hey.
I love Clear's work. It's so fun.
Yeah.
I was honestly really hoping that I would pick this one up because I love it. You remember this one?
I do.
I feel like I showed this off last year, but it's just so cute. Oh, this is confusing. Wait, there's your
face. Hey. Oh, no. I've been had. Oh, I've been had.
It's just so nice. Oh, I didn't realize you can like slightly. Let me line that up. Well, that's me entertaining for the rest of the day. 2018 Hallozeen Visual Feast by Jess Haas, Anamique Decker, and Cassidy Shit. Sorry, I'm taking a picture of this.
So cute.
It is poetry, illustration, shitty Halloween costume generator. Which would you like me to do yours for you?
Sure.
Okay, first letter of first name is A, so that's a witch. First letter of first surname. No, first letter of surname. Witch, scientist, and from hell. Witch, scientist, from hell.
Good.
Hey.
I'll take it.
Mine is sexy banana with thigh high socks. Okay.
Oh, well. We can't all be witch scientists from hell. Can't all be witch
scientists from hell. A little bit of everything. It's shaped like a video cassette. This was a gift from a friend in England, I think, called Angela. It is an illustrated story about Angela Lansbury and Murder, She Wrote.
Oh, nice.
It's very lovely. Very beautiful, bold color scheme. I am a big fan of Murder, She Wrote, so I appreciate that. And I tell a lot of people, I like Murder, She Wrote a lot. It's fun. It was my go-to television when I had chicken pox. Can mostly cognizantly remember a lot of Murder, She Wrote. This one is Yokai by Tina Tran. Really pretty. It's a little black and yellow Rizzo. Guide to Demons. So pretty.
Oh my goodness. That's so nice.
They're really lovely. Another Alex Clark. I think it's almost like you run this event and put something out for it every single time.
Yeah, it's just make other people peer pressure me into doing my own work.
Yeah. So this is just your decompression of researching Rose Parade, is it not?
Mm-hmm.
Including
pictures
of Special Boy for a reason.
Yep.
Negochet.
Oh.
Who lives up in Sydney, the walls of King Street, and it is big, long, accordion folded book.
That's so nice.
I know. Mostly just about feral lads. It is a story of feral lads going to a house party. It's a tableau. Beautiful. But it's just guys getting on the beers, but also they have wolf heads. Yeah, packs of tipsy white dudes walking around.
That's King Street.
Yep. So just, yeah. But congratulations on humanizing the Cis White Male Meg. I appreciate it. Is this another one of yours? Is this one we were making of the little one?
Yeah, probably. Yeah, that seems about right. Right. Is it just a cover?
Wow.
Oh. Wow. Just turning into a pet.
And then, oh gosh, the little guy on the back. But it's definitely from the same period.
It could be Nara.
It does look like Nara's handwriting, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Good to see that. I love that it just descends into chaos at the end.
Yeah.
Lesbian lycanthropy is another leaf noble. It's just cute little. And so my friend Gianna, who lives in New York, they have a really cute print of hers in here as well. She has a resist ego. Look at them. It's adorable.
Oh, so cute.
So cute. She does comics from time to time, but it goes in the pile because it's the dark outfit of the day. That's too cute. Very sweet. I love Gigi's art. Gigi's wonderful. Let's collab this one because I feel like I haven't talked about Ive enough.
Yeah.
I haven't talked about Ive at all, which is a shame. I should talk about him more. He's so good. So fun. Love when he puts stuff out because it's always kind of like, okay, here it is. Like, as far as I'm concerned, I don't know. Does he spend a lot of time agonizing about it at home?
Yeah. But like, he'll just go and rewrite it by himself. Yeah, I like that he doesn't tell me the jokes before he's written it and then finished the zine, so I get to enjoy it perfectly as its final form. I think I like the one in that zine where it's like, there are three switches and nobody knows what they do. That's just our house.
Thank you, Alex. This has been a treat. Lovely to see you.
Have a good rest of the day. Yeah.
Yeah, you too. Bye.
Have a good...
Bye-bye.
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 Hello. Lovely to meet you. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Hey, folks. My name is Tash, and I love creating mess, cut and pasting, and making zines. I run workshops and collaborate through the platform known as a zine thing.
What kinds of zines do you usually make?
I generally write emotionally drawn-out prose that become per zines, and themed art or collaborations in projects on occasion too.
Can you show us some of your favorite Halloweenish zines?
Ooh, does Defula count? Not spooky by nature, but name because I love it. Otherwise, probably have to say one of my all-time favorites. Arachnacid, a short black and white zine that was the first of many dark tales that became a limited edition publication. The digital version is still available for download by Matt Nichols and Ross Stewart Boy in our box productions. Albeit a tad biased, Matt is my husband.
Have you made a Hallozeen for this year? What is it about?
I have been writing a lot actually. But it's more of the same content-wise as I have previously done. Exploring the sentiment of this time of year, reflections, etc. More interestingly, my Hallozeen for this year is going to be a first for me. A digitally uploaded one. Fingers crossed it works out.
I find that zines are a nice medium for telling stories that start as a troubling concept or fascination that you tell people a few times until the story develops its own rhythm and beats. So once it's articulated as a small booklet, it's captured and finite. My question is, do you have a weird story that you've struggled to express, but were compelled to keep telling it to make it make sense? How would you make a zine out of it? Have you done this?
You've struck something there. Zine making has become such an integral process of exploring stories, or moments, or ideas that taunt me, and need to be unraveled to digest. But then not all the zines I make are copied and distributed.
Halloween is a bit weird in Australia, and has a free-form meaning to a lot of people. What's your favorite vibe about Halloween?
We had friends from Canada that introduced us to the holiday in the 90s as teens. We would walk around with our younger siblings, but few people knew what we were doing. One fella wrapped a biscuit up in tin foil and made out they were miniature UFOs. As he flew them into their sacks, I thought that was a cool quick thinking fix. Prior to that, we never celebrated, but movies like Hocus Pocus and The Craft were watched repeatedly. Now our kids help us each year to prepare for the potential of trick-or-treaters by tracing outlines of each other's bodies on the crossover or footpath or road with chalk and splatter with food coloring or beetroot juice for added effect. We usually watch episodes of Monster Squad Daggy Old Teleseries and eat Pop Rocks, Sherbet and Pez.
Ghosts of me. Ghosts of me. Ghosts of me. Ghosts of me. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back. There's a ghost in my house. A ghost of your memories.
There's a ghost in my house.
The ghost of the love you took from me.
The ghost of the love you took from me.
Where our love used to be. Only shadows from the past I see.
Only shadows from the past I see.
Time can't seem to erase.
Can't seem to erase.
The vision of your smiling face.
The vision of your smiling face.
Though you found someone new.
Though you found someone new.
I can't get over you.
There's a ghost in my house.
I can't hide. From the ghost of your love that's inside. It keeps on haunting me. It just keeps on reminding me. In my mind, I know you're gone, but my heart keeps holding on to the memories of those happy times, to the love that once was mine. Though we're far apart, you're all in my heart. There's a ghost in my house. I can't hide from the ghost of your love that's inside. You're still such a part of me, still so deep in the heart of me. Just keep hearing your footsteps on the stairs. When I know there's no one there. Every day I love you more. So much more than the day before. Sitting in my easy chair, I feel your fingers running through my hair. Looking down in my coffee cup, I think I see your face looking up. All alone in my gloom, your voice echoes through the room. There's a ghost in my house, I can't hide from the ghost of your love that's inside. It keeps on haunting me, just keeps on reminding me. I just keep hearing your footsteps on the stairs. When I know there's no one there, you're still such a part of me, still so deep in the heart of me. I can't hide.
Baron, I wonder if I might ask, who was the young woman I saw in the window before you came to the door?
Young woman? Oh, I'm afraid you're mistaken.
No, I'm not mistaken. I saw her. Dark hair and eyes, about 20.
Well, I'm quite sure you think you saw someone, but...
Baron, I am in full possession of my faculties.
Please, allow me to show you something.
Roma started a conversation upon occult subjects. He told us the most ghastly story of a vampire that you've ever heard. I hope you won't hear it, at any rate until you're stronger, and mind if you do that you don't go to sleep on it. Then, Esme Corcoon's fracas. His story was in a more poetic strain, but was quite as creepy. It described a moral vampire, a human being with the power of absorbing into his own system all the vitality and will force of anyone peculiarly susceptible to magnetic influence, till a poor creature lost all individuality and became a mere shell, galvanized into obedience by the will of its destroyer. Isn't that a horrible notion? I dream of it, and a weird impression has taken hold of me that Esme Corcoon is just such a monster and that he has selected Judith for his victim. Haven't you ever remarked what strength of will he has? You can't look at him without feeling it. I have heard Christine Bourlais say that he might do anything if he only had tenacity of purpose. But that is the way with poets. Roma started a conversation upon occult subjects. Roma started a conversation upon occult subjects. The story was in a more poetic strain. Described a moral vampire, a moral vampire, a human being with the power of absorbing into his own system, into his own system, into his own system. Vitality and will force. Vitality and will force. Vitality and will force. Vitality and will force. Vitality.
Examine the portrait closely, the signature,
and above notion? All,
the date.
1786?
Isn't it
that's
a horrible
20 years
notion?
Ago. It's incredible. It's the same girl, and she hasn't changed a bit.
She has been dead for 20 years.
With all respect, Baron, for a ghost, she's a very active young woman.
Shortly after 1 a.m. and the lights went up and the bar staff started hovering around those of us left on the dance floor, poised with reams of blue roll to clean up the sticky spillages we were dancing on. I climbed up the stairs to the street and walked briskly towards King's Cross. I took out my phone and searched for the quickest route home as I walked down York Way, dismayed but not surprised to find that all of the suggested trips would take over 90 minutes. I refreshed the app optimistically, hoping that an alternative, faster route that didn't involve strings of connecting night buses and lengthy waits at cold bus stops would appear, but the options remained the same. As I neared the main drag by the station, where I'd have to make a decision about which way to turn, I gave up and decided to order an Uber. I stood outside the McDonald's on the corner of York Way and Pentonville Road, and stood in the bright glow of the window, tapping at my phone as crowds of Saturday night drinkers weaved past me, in and out of the double doors, smelling of cigarette smoke and chips. An Uber trip home would cost me £31, which was expensive. Conversely, an Uber pool trip would cost £13. I was wary of using the pool option. I'd heard from friends that you only had 1 minute to make it into the cab once it arrived at the designated meeting point. So if you weren't in exactly the right place, you ended up racking up cancellations and charges, but I decided to give it a go and press the button to confirm the trip. The cab would be arriving for another 6 minutes. I studied the number plate and make of the car so I'd be able to recognise it when it arrived. I tried to follow its progress on the tracker, but the on-screen trajectory of the little car representing my cab was confusing and I put my phone back in my pocket. Then, a minute or so later, I got anxious and got it out again to check, repeating this cycle several times. The cab was getting closer, 2 minutes away. I looked up and my eyes locked onto a grey car, which was the same number plate as my cab. I started towards it, but the car didn't stop and turned a corner further down the road. This rattled me a bit, but the app assured me that the cab was still 2 minutes away. I could see it now on the screen, looping back around the block. Traffic was bad for 1:20 in the morning, and it seemed to take ages for the car to make it back round to the meeting place. I became nervous that I was standing in the wrong place, and jogged up the road a little, and then changed my mind and jogged back again. Shortly after, the grey car pulled up, and I got into the back seat. The driver and I exchanged cursory pleasantries. Yes, I'd had a good night. Yes, he was very busy. We set off to pick up the next passenger. This took ages and I was starting to feel very tired. We got caught by almost every red light as we wove our way agonisingly slowly towards the city. We wiggled through the side streets, following a bizarre route designed to beat the traffic, but which inevitably deposited us back out onto a congested road again after a few minutes of twists and turns. Eventually, we pulled over in a dead-end street. A bleached blonde woman in heels tottered over to the cab and got in the back. She was slightly older than me, deeply tanned. She and the driver said hello, and then he introduced us. "Katie, this is Katie," he said, and we all laughed politely. I imagine Katie was as used to bumping into Katies as I was, but despite the routine nature of the interaction, a funny feeling came over me as I locked eyes with the other Katie, the hairs on the back of my neck standing up and forcing me to search for a reason why. Whilst we were styled completely differently, I could tell she was the same build as me, same hair texture, similar asymmetry to her face under a tan. "You're right, you have a good night," she asked me in a husky Irish accent, which jolted me back into the moment. It was enough to stop me searching for similarities. We all made small talk for a couple of minutes, before Katie looked at her phone and I stared out the window as reading in the car always made me feel a bit sick. Katie was a heavy breather, which I ignored for a few minutes before I looked around and realised she was asleep with her head lolling to the side. The driver and I didn't speak again, in deference to the sleeping Katie. The traffic north of the river had been terrible, but once we got over Tower Bridge, things started moving, and it wasn't too long before we arrived at the other Katie's flat. "Katie," said the driver, she didn't stir. "Katie, we're here." That time she heard and jerked upright. "Gran, thanks so much. Have a good night," she said blearily as she groped around for her bag and shoes, which she'd slipped off at some point. She got out of the car barefoot and padded over to the door of the building, seeming drunker than she had when she'd gotten in the cab. There was something unusual about her clothes and hairstyle that I couldn't help with my finger on. Someone else that I couldn't make out clearly was approaching the door at the same time as the other Katie, and they chatted as the other person fumbled with their keys and let them both in. The driver tapped at his phone. "Where do you live again?" I told him, and he entered the postcode into the sat nav.
Hi all, Peter out here. Happy launch party. I was going to write a spooky song, but I thought I'd play you a song I found on a tape instead. It's by a young cameraman named Dennis Holder, who wrote it shortly before he went missing, 31 years ago this month. You see, 1990 was a scary time to be a teenager in Canberra.
A juvenile heavy metal cult was raging out of control in Tuggeranong. The report quoted police sources who said the cult gangs were responsible for 50% of crime in the area.
Before he disappeared, Dennis saw a group of teenagers beheading a Persian cat in the woods around Narrabunda. The boys wore cloaks and chanted Satan's name. He didn't tell anyone, but he did write about it in his diary, which was found along with its tape after he disappeared. When I play it, I could almost sense what happened to him. Each night is long, like another hour of mass. I look above, but the ceiling, it remains blank. I'm as afraid of the light of the day. So many faces, they appear around me. Oh, the light, I'm beginning to feel so cold. Oh, the light, I'm beginning to feel so cold.
And present today, we're very distressed by the claims in the Times. The
problem is now that we're all in the one bag, we're all criminals. Yeah, all, now, this is what
all
we
Metallica
wear.
Ones are now a one gang as far as this.
I wear one every day and I've never broken into a house. Yeah, I've been in no trouble with the law. I've got earring, Metallica shirt, jeans, everything, no trouble.
And he's a Christian.
Right. I'm a Christian.
And that says something.
That says something. I'm a Christian.
And that says something.
That says something.
Thank you.
Worth, Hallozeen. Worth. Having a spooky Halloween. We've been Crash the CP Art, got a new album coming out soon. Watch this space. Let's get down to it.
Done the right thing, but this time around. My antennas have sensed you are a terrible driver.